I want to welcome you to worship here at Willie United Methodist Church. My name is Christina Dowling-Soka, and I, along with my spouse, Jody Dowling-Soka, have the great joy of being the pastors here in Willow, Alaska. And we are thrilled that you have decided to be a part of our online church family today. You are very important to us, and we pray that this service will be a blessing to you. We were away at a family reunion in Greeley, Colorado, when this service took place. We are thankful to Jeff Bertrand, who is our preacher for the morning, to Deanna, who brings the children's message, and to Julie Mitchell, our lay leader, for being our liturgist. And a very special thank you to Mary Lemmings for the beautiful piano music. And now we pray that the Holy Spirit will lift you up during this time. Welcome in the name of Christ.
All right, we'll now have a prelude for Mary.
Here, find guidance.
Come,
front, please.
Good morning, everybody.
us into your new creation, that we might welcome you to more fully become the ruler of our hearts and minds. Through him who came as a servant and who now reigns over all creation, Jesus our Christ.
Hear the assurance of pardon. There is no wall that God cannot tear down. There is no wrong that God cannot forgive. Immerse yourselves in the healing waters of God's forgiveness. Be restored. Let God make you whole.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Done with that old life.
It's like a filthy set of ill-fitting clothes you've stripped off and put in the fire. Now you're dressed in a new wardrobe. Every item of your new way of life is custom made by the Creator with His label on it. All the old fashions are now obsolete. Words like Jewish and non-Jewish, religious and irreligious, insider and outsider, uncivilized and uncouth, slave and free, mean nothing. From now on, everyone is defined by Christ. Everyone is included in Christ.
Amen.
The gospel reading is from Luke chapter 12. Someone out in the crowd said, "Teacher, order my brother to give me a fair share of the family inheritance." He replied, "Mister, what makes you think it's any of my business to be a judge or mediator for you?" Speaking to the people, he went on, "Take care. Protect yourself against the least bit of greed. Life is not defined by what you have, even when you have a lot." Then he told them this story. The farm of a certain rich man produced a terrific crop. He talked to himself, "What can I do? My barn isn't big enough for this harvest." Then he said, "Here's what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. Then I'll gather in all my grain and goods, and I'll say to myself, 'Self, you've done well. You've got it made and can now retire. Take it easy and have the time of your life.'" Just then, God showed up and said, "Fool, tonight you die, and your barn full of goods, who gets it?" That's what happens when you fill your barn with self and not with God. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Adding a wood job onto the back so I could have have more room for my stuff. And then, I don't know, maybe I should, because then I'll just die. And then, of course, the epistle lesson didn't help either. Although the part I like about it is the part where it says this first verse, so if you're serious about living this new resurrection life with Christ, act like it. Act. And I can stop right there, that'd be fine. But then Deanna had to read the part about not being irritable and grouchy and other things. Of course, that's pretty much all I've been. Have you ever tried to find quiet time with five little kids running around? Two of them are babies, screaming and crying. And it's been pretty hard to find just some quiet time to think about what I was going to do today. But the kids, they help a lot. We can learn stuff from kids. We can learn stuff from Scripture. We can learn from other people. This morning, I'm going to talk about a gentleman named James Martin. He wrote this book called My Life with the Saints. He's a Jesuit priest. And he talks about the impact that the lives of these saints have had with him. Not just people who have passed on, but people alive today. Of course, in the Catholic tradition, the saint is someone who's been a marvelous Christian, done a lot of wonderful things in your life, and has passed on, and then been, what do they call it, by the church, the Pope, called a saint, I guess. But technically, anybody who's a Christian who dies is a saint in our understanding. You can learn a lot from people. I know there's problems with some of us in the Presbyterian Protestant faith, looking at Catholics, thinking they worship the saints and they don't. But everybody knows, they all know that, as we say, all you really need is Jesus, and all these people would agree as well. But sometimes it's easier to learn from people who have been here among us and are among us than it is just reading the scripture. I have always had a problem with just learning from Jesus because Jesus is God. The argument that because Jesus died for our sins and suffered on the cross, we should believe in him is always a little difficult for me because I think of all those people throughout history, throughout humanity, who have suffered and died even more than Jesus did. And remember, Jesus on the cross wasn't allowed to suffer real long, right? Not a bone was broken. It was typical in crucifixions if it was getting too long or coming up to the Sabbath day to break the legs of those hanging there so that they would suffocate and die sooner. But enough of that. This guy writes about seeing these saints as models of holiness relevant to contemporary believers. And to understand the remarkable works of God, the remarkable ways God works in the lives of each. Each saint was holy in his own unique way, revealing how God celebrates individuality. And C.S. Lewis, the great theologian of the 20th century, says in Your Christianity, how monotonously alike are all the great tyrants and conquerors have been, but how gloriously different the saints have been. Well, James Martin, who wrote this book, gave a series of lectures and tried to answer the question of how to find God. And after he did that, he was asked to put it in the form of a book. So he came up with a list that included religious leaders, public figures, writers, and so on. And he received responses from all over the world that included a cardinal in the church, famous writers, even the White House. And he received rejections. One of the more interesting ones was from Carl Sagan, the astronomer, who said, the question, how can I find God, assumes the answer to the key undecided issue, which is, does God exist? He received an answer back from the office of the Pope, saying, in effect, we appreciate the request, but cannot comply. But the best rejection that he got came from the daughter of an Albanian grocer named Agnes Ganju Bujatsu, something like that, who we all know as Mother Teresa. Let me read the rejection letter that she wrote back to him. She said, "God love you for your real effort to lead people nearer to his truth and love. I will certainly keep this project in my prayers, that Jesus may use this book for the glory of God and the good of his people. I regret to inform you, however, that I will be unable to contribute to the book you requested. Keep the joy of loving Jesus in your heart and share this joy with all you need. Let us pray. God bless you, Mother Teresa." She also included a card. And if you forget everything else I said today, which would probably not be a bad idea, at least remember this month. The fruit of silence is prayer. The fruit of prayer is faith. The fruit of faith is love. The fruit of love is service. And the fruit of service is peace. All love acting. Mother Teresa would come to run the Missionaries of Charity in Calcutta, India, serving the poorest of the poor, teaching in the slums, providing some level of medical care, and often just being a presence among those who are dying. So they wouldn't have to die alone, so they'd have a friendly face to look at, a hand. She was born in 1910. When she was 18 years old, she joined the Loretto Sisters in Dublin, Ireland. And a few months later, she journeyed to India, where she would spend the rest of her life. After 18 years, after an extraordinary spiritual experience, where she was actually on a train to take a little vacation, because she was so exhausted, going to Darjeeling, that she had this remarkable experience where she felt God talking to her, saying, "Wouldst thou care for these?" Of course. Eventually, she started the Missionaries of Charity. It wasn't easy. It took about a year just to get to that part because she had to get approval from the church, from her immediate superiors, and eventually from the Pope, to leave the convent and start this mission on her own. Let me just read a couple paragraphs from this book about her. Added to the mental and emotional challenges of beginning this journey were practical ones. Before beginning her service to the poor, she had to undergo medical training with a medical mission and sisters. Next, she had to search for a place to stay, finding temporary lodgings in a convent of the Little Sisters of the Poor in Calcutta. Once settled, she began teaching in the slums, dressed in a simple sari of blue and white, scratching letters in the mud with a stick before the poor children squatted next to her. In a short while, she located a small house in town where she began attracting the first of her sisters. Many other helpers, doctors, nurses, and lay people gathered around the new missionaries of charity to aid them in their work with the poor. And eventually she founded the Place of the Immaculate Heart, housed in a building that originally served as a pilgrim's rest home for Hindus visiting the Kali Temple next door. But despite her charitable work, welcoming people from all faiths, there was noticeable hostility directed toward this foreign Christian woman and her companions, who appeared to be pushing their way into Hindu territory. People threw stones at them and threatened them, and one man tried to kill Mother Teresa. But their hostility was met with love and always with more service. At one point, a group of young Hindus entered the Place of the Immaculate Heart to turn out Mother Teresa. But having witnessed the care with which the suffering, emaciated bodies of the poor were tended, he returned to his fellow protesters outside with the directive that he would evict Mother Teresa and the sisters, but only on one condition, namely, that they would pursue persuade their mothers and sisters to undertake the same service. Some years ago, when I was still online, I had a co-pilot who had the privilege to meet Mother Teresa. He and his wife lived in Southern California, and she worked for a NGO, non-governmental organization, that helped people throughout the world. And they were able to travel to Calcutta and be here. What was remarkable to me was the way my co-pilot's reaction, his reaction. He was really touched by her presence, noticeably moved. Even a few weeks later when we flew together, it was even more remarkable because he was not a Christian. He was an agnostic at best. But the door of faith had been opened in him by Mother Teresa. He was inspired, challenged, moved. Even for me at that time, there was something about that encounter just with him that was very, very, very strange. Mother Teresa accepted the people that she ministered, wherever they were, acting in the services of love. What if we did the same? How different could it be? What impact would we have on those around us? We can learn from scriptures, we can learn from other people, we can learn from kids. So last Tuesday, I had the privilege of watching my granddaughter's pink birdhouse. Kira did this one. And she said, "It's beautiful." And her cousin said, "Yes, it's beautiful." June, the older one, did this one and said, "It's beautiful." And Kira said, "Yes, it's beautiful." And then they pulled out the one that they did together. And they said, "That's our best one yet. It's beautiful." It was really touching just to listen to them, accepting each other's abilities as they were. Not correcting, not critiquing, not adding anything else to it. Accepting and serving. So I started preparing for this talk with the idea of a troubling question that I have recently with friends of mine that differ remarkably with my views on certain things, sometimes very troubling. And I thought, how can I deal with this? I've seen other friends in recent years, actually very recently, who have had been sworn off as friends because they don't believe as they do. And I thought, what could we learn from Scripture? What could I learn from these saints how to deal with other people? And what I see in the stories that I've read today, and what I've been convicted by, is just to accept each other as we are. Direct us,
O Lord, in all our duties, with your most gracious favor, and further us with your continual help, that in all our works, begun, continued, and ended in you, we share your love, glorifying your holy name, and finally, by your mercy, obtain every blessing. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Mary and Julia.